Well, dozens of people murdered and 10 years of painful waiting. The quest for justice finally bore fruit on Thursday after Quezon City Judge Jocelyn Solis Reyes handed down a 761-page ruling on the gruesome Maguindanao massacre case. But even then, it got Filipinos asking, is justice worth the wait? Or was the waiting a sign of a flawed justice system? Joining us today for his insights, UP Constitutional Law Professor Tony La Viña. Good afternoon, sir. Welcome back to ANC.
Good afternoon.
Hi. So, all these, there's a question posed there already. Is this really a sign that we can move on?
Yeah. Yes and no. It's imperfect justice. We know that, and we can talk about that a little bit later. Some form of justice was achieved here. The judge did a very good and thorough job with a few gaps here and there, but I'm not gonna second guess her, especially on the evidence and appreciation of the evidence. But there are big gaps, particularly with respect to the families of the victims, including the 58 victim who clearly was not given. There is no justice for the family of the 58 victim here, because no one was convicted of that particular crime because of the lack of evidence. And of course, dozens are still out there at large, still to be arrested and still to be tried. Those acquitted, I understand where the judge is coming from, and she really was just very straightforward in applying the theory of conspiracy, the jurisprudence on conspiracy, that you need overt acts to be part, to be held liable for a conspiracy, even if you knew it was happening. But there are, I think, also various ways to go after those people. Administratively, for example, but no longer for these crimes. Have to be very separate, because you cannot put people on double jeopardy for the same crime that they have been acquitted for. It's imperfect justice. I mean, and the fact that it took quite a long time is something to ponder about. I mean, this was understandable because of nearly 100 accused.
Suspects, yeah.
And you have to actually prove every single one. I mean, just Judge Solis is very good in identifying what each and everyone did or did not do. And that's important. That meant she listened to evidence and made sure evidence was shown. Prosecutors showed evidence, and the defense had a chance to combat that, of every single thing that someone did or not do. That takes a long time, and that's why you have lots and lots of voluminous records for this. But we have to think about, you know, what do you do when you are faced with this again? And that's my final point. This will happen again. Because the culture of warlordism and political dynasties in the country is alive. And this is the reason why this happened. This was state violence at its extreme. This was enabled by the national government, by decades of enabling political families like this to think that they are above the law. And that conditions continue all over the country. Ironically, it is in Maguindanao, where you have the Bangsamoro, now newly established, with the MLF heading it, that has the least chance of this happening again. Because the political system there is a parliamentary form of system of government, a ministerial form of government. To govern the Bangsamoro after they have their elections, you will have to have factions coming together. No single family will be able to control the Bangsamoro anymore. That's the theory around a ministerial form of government. So I'm actually hopeful for Maguindanao, but I'm not hopeful for other parts of the Philippines where you still have political families that think that they're above the law.
Is that where it ends, legally speaking, in terms of the law? How else do we avoid this kind of violence happening again? How do we avoid political dynasties and warlordism?
A constitutional provision, or even a law that implements the current constitutional provision that prohibits family dynasties, a political family, is really the best way to stop this from happening. A very strict law that doesn't allow local politicians to make the people convicted, the actual people who actually did the killing, many of them were policemen or employees of the provincial government. So very strict laws that doesn't allow politicians to control state forces, right? Local or national police forces is very important to get this to happen. Making the military cut ties with citizen arms, kafgus, etc. You know the truth is that private armies has also been used by the military to fight the perceived enemies of the state, the NPA, the MLF before the peace agreement. The Ampatuans were the bulwark of the state against the MLF, right? I do not know what the military did or did not do here, that's not clear. But, you know, they probably knew that movement was happening. I mean, everyone knew that this was going to happen, or lots of people knew, lots of people were in the meeting. If they have good intelligence, they would have known. Why didn't they stop it, right? So there you have to have a military that is not linked to politicians. That's very, very important. And does not rely on private armies or citizen armies or militia for their mandated duties. Mm.
So those are some of your recommendations. But what does this verdict actually change in terms of, the call for political and judicial reforms, as well as, you know, the purported culture of impunity that we have here in the country, or how politicians deal with journalists?
This was a blow against impunity. That's for sure. Because as I said, what this tells you, it might take a long time, but you cannot get away with it. This is a crime against humanity. It's horrific, right? It's like the killings in the war against drugs. It's horrific. No matter what you do, you cannot hide it. Too many people know. What's interesting here, everyone should really try to read 700 pages.
Right.
The testimonies are quite amazing. I mean, the extent of the people involved here, including those acquitted. Imagine you have a big meeting, lots of high officials of the province and the arm attending the meeting, coming to an agreement to kill this group of people, their political rivals, all out in the open, you know. Some of those people got acquitted or were not even charged because they did not participate in the actual commission. And that's the rule in conspiracy. Conspiracy, you have to prove that a crime was agreed upon to be committed and people actually participated in the committing of that crime. No matter what participation, but you have to have participation.
So in your initial reading of the 761-page verdict, was it the witness testimonies that really struck, stood out for you?
Yes.
And, what about, there was a lot of testimony there on payoffs allegedly made to some government officials. Can you use these for cases?
For administrative cases. Mm-hmm. I think there can be administrative cases, especially for those who were in the meetings but were not charged. I mean, there might be administrative cases you could file. The policemen that were acquitted because all they did really was just be in the checkpoints and they didn't. I think that's but you could file administrative cases against them. But there were two types of witnesses here that were very important. The first type were those who were in the meetings, those close to the Ampatuans, those who turned state witness, who were actually part of but played minor parts in the conspiracy, and then they turn and say, well, in this meeting, this person said this person. They were all consistent about that. The second type of witnesses were those who actually saw the killing and observed the people that were actually killed, how they were killed. So Datu Unsay, for example, is a principal by participating. He was actually the one that did the killing, that did the leading. But former armed governor Saldi Ampatuan is convicted on the basis of his statements and of the things he did after, like going to Manila so that it would not be obvious, things like that, words like that got him convicted, and those were by the witnesses that were inside the Ampatuan agreement or conspiracy.
Right. And, you know, in a recent interview, you also said, and you mentioned it again today, that you believe that the Ampatuan massacre, the Maguindanao massacre, was a state-sanctioned state violence to the extreme. Are you referring to allegations that former President Gloria Arroyo had intervened at several points in this case leading up actually to the Maguindanao massacre, that she had tried to dissuade Mangudadato from running for governor filing a complaint against the election?
No, I'm actually not referring to the politics here. I mean, except to say that presidents have always played politics in arm, no, and in those provinces, and as I said, it's a good thing that we now have the Bangsamoro, and the Bangsamoro is run by the MLF. That's independent of all of these politicians and independent of the president. It's very important, independent of the president. There, from what I see, the MLF is dependent on their central committee and on their mass base rather than on other politicians. But what I'm saying here is that president after president, this is not just Arroyo, relied on the Ampatuans and before that other families to deliver votes for them, you know, in elections. And because of that, turned a blind eye to whatever the Ampatuans were doing. They were talking about chainsaw killings and people being killed here left and right because they were seen as enemies. And the Ampatuans were allowed to do that. And so it got to them, I suppose. I mean, it's very chilling, the testimonies about that meeting. You know, it's like, who are they to contest us? We have to kill them. They cannot contest us, right? This is our kingdom. This is ours. And the Mangatus are going to take it away from us, and we will not allow it. And everyone is agreeing. And you know, there are lawyers there. There are free government officials there, and they're saying yes, 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 yes. Whether they meant it or not, or just saying to the patriarch, you're right, you're right. It's the patriarch that's driving this. I mean, if he survived, he would have been convicted for sure as a principal and actually as the mastermind, based on the testimony.
And
that Unsa is the leader, the one who actually led the killing and did some of the killing based on the testimony.
Right. Would you call this then a successfully tried case? There were times when former Justice Secretary Laila De Lima had sought to ensure that the case is tried swiftly. So did former Justice Secretary, Chief Justice Maria Lourdes Sereno. Do you think
this was an imperfectly tried case, but a good outcome? But imperfect outcome. Let's be clear about that. If you ask me what is the most important thing to be done, there's several, but number one is the security of the families. Because ironically, this verdict puts them in more danger. Just among others, because some of the people convicted here will actually be able to walk out in a few years because they've already served 10 years. So those who are convicted for 20 years, for example, with GCTA, good kind, etc., they'll be able to walk out earlier. Because some of the family were actually acquitted, and conceivably, if they really want to, could make decisions and command other people, and of course they are back in power in that part of the Philippines. So the 58th victim is very important.
Right.
That was immensely doable in my view. Not the judge's fault. You asked me about the TSS. The one big gap here from what I've been reading is the failure to do really good forensic investigation, forensic evidence,
right.
DNA evidence, you know what I mean? But that was not enough, right? I mean, could have done other things to establish that he was one of those that were actually there. So that for me is quite important. And then the third would be to get those who are at large.
Right.
Some are saying that the actual shooters, many of the actual shooters are the ones who were actually at large.
Hmm.
I have no idea of whether that's true or not.
And those are the next step, the security of the victims' families, as well as the search for justice for the 58th victim, as well as the search and capture of the remaining almost 100 suspects. UP Constitutional Law Professor Tony La Viña, thank you so much for joining us today. We appreciate your time and insights.
Thank you.